joining me today, the Lunatic Fringe, WWE World Champion, Dean Ambrose. Dean, how are you?
I'm good, man. I couldn't be doing any better.
Rocking a tap out gear. Before we came on live, we was talking pickup trucks and country music. I didn't expect that out of you.
So why is that?
I don't know. I was thinking maybe grunge era, thinking music influences. Yeah, I didn't think country.
I like grunge music. I'm from that era. I'm from the 90s. Yeah, I like a little bit of everything music-wise, you know? I don't like genre specifically. I think there's good music. There's good country music, bad country music. Good rock music, bad rock music. I really like, I like old country, like I was saying. You know, I like Waylon, Merle, you know, the old stuff. You know, keep it on Willie's Roadhouse, Channel 59 on XM, or Outlaw Country, you know. I like the old stuff, you know. You heard some of, like, the newer country they got now? Like,
dude, there's a select few that I will.
Dude, if you turn on a regular radio station now,
I'm not mentioning any names. I know. That's why I'm kind of stuck in my world. I kind of dig what I dig. I use the Pandora radio. I won't drop my name, but I want to take you back. You're talking about the old days of country music. Let's talk about your early days growing up, because what was it like for a kid like you, Dean Ambrose, coming from the mean streets of Cincinnati, Ohio? What was life like in your formative years?
I'm from, like I said, I'm from Cincinnati. The Nasty Natty, yo.
Also the home of Brian Pillman, my old tag team partner.
True, true. And Jerry Springer. But you didn't know that one. Yeah. So they, me, Pillman, Jerry Springer, that's what Cincinnati's giving you. And Carmen Electra, maybe. They have to check on that one. But
tell me about growing up.
Yeah, so, me and my mom worked, we lived in an apartment, little apartment. My mom worked overnights, so like she'd be gone from like 10, 11 at night till like 7 in the morning, whatever. And my dad had, he lived out of the state, so me and my sister kind of would just kind of have the, we kind of learned to figure out for ourselves. You know, my mom would come home and sleep all day, which I think I kind of gained kind of my wandering kind of spirit, maybe, because me and my sister just kind of figured out how to do stuff on our own, how to make macaroni and cheese or whatever on our own. We just kind of wandered the streets, you know, learned things, met people, did our thing, and just kind of, you know, me and my sister just kind of figured it out for ourselves, and we became very, very independent. And, you know, I really love that I was, I really love that kind of upbringing for myself. You know, it created me into the person that I am. You know, I just kind of.
But what kind of relationship did you have with your father? Was he living out of state, working out of state?
He worked out of state for his job. You know, my parents divorced when I was pretty young, but my dad works in a factory. And my mom, my mom was able to just quit her job at a factory. And I'd been trying to get her to quit it for a little while since I started having a little more of a run here. And that's probably the greatest accomplishment I've had in wrestling, just because I've been able to, you know, do pretty well for myself. My mom's worked in this factory for 13 years, 12 plus hours a day, like, you know, in a hot, sweaty factory or whatever. And I was able to just be like, Mom, would you just quit your job already? And I was able to pay her house off, and so she could quit her job. And it was probably the best accomplishment I can say that I've had in wrestling, you know.
But would you say that you had a happy childhood?
Yeah, I really would. You wouldn't expect that?
No, I just read public housing, and was my research wrong? Was there no public housing?
No, but I was happy because...
No public housing?
Yeah, I mean...
You were happy?
Yeah.
Which one?
I was happy, you know. I didn't know any different, you know. Like, I don't have any kind of, like, sob story that, you know, like, a lot of people like to be like, oh, you know, I came from this terrible situation that happened, and but that's everybody. Everybody's got their own story, and then, you know.
But you said that way of life led you to your wandering ways. Let's segue into school. What kind of student were you?
When I was in, like, elementary school, whatever, third or fourth, fifth grade, when I was, like, a young kid, I was actually pretty good at school. Like, I get all straight A's. Like, school came very easy to me. Like, you know, I was very good reading, verily, stuff like that. I mean, to me, it was easy, you know, read the book, take the test, you know what I mean? School actually usually came very easily to me. Once I got into, like, middle school, like, that area, once you start having the point where you can start kind of having an independent thought in your brain, and you start asking the question of, like, okay, why do I have to learn this? Or like, do I really got to get on this bus and go to school? Because like, what's the point? Who's telling me I got to do this? Maybe do I really have to go? Why are we learning this? Then I kind of started really like not caring about school as much. By the time I got to high school, I hated school. I could do good. Like, school was very easy to me. You know, if I wanted to get straight A's, I'd pretty easily get straight A's. I'm not saying that because I'm a genius.
So did you not care? Was there no work ethic there? What was the disconnect?
I think it's not a work ethic thing, because I had a, you know, I definitely not a work ethic thing. I'm a guy who I believe myself to be a very strong work ethic, and I'm very proud of that. I just kind of felt like, and this is partially being young and stupid, and I'm not saying I would do it the same way going back, you know, because I ended up dropping out. I never finished school. At some point, I just left. At the time, though, I just was just like, why are we learning this? Why do I got to do this? This is, like, I would look at the teachers and stuff and be like.
So you were always questioning things.
Yeah, like, why do I got to learn this so I can come and have your terrible job one day? Like, I don't want to do any of this. Like, I just, like, I thought I was smarter than everybody here, you know? Like, and so, I'm not saying that was, you know, that was just me being immature and so forth. And by the time I was, you know, 16, 17, I was already starting to explore the world of wrestling, which is all I really wanted to do in the first place. I mean,
We get to wrestling, let's stay with the education. Did you do any high school sports? Were you any kind of activities?
Oh, yeah, I did wrestling junior high and high school. Did play a little football in high school.
How long did you wrestle?
Till from like sixth grade until I stopped going to school. I was actually pretty good. The problem with me and like in wrestling and in football, because I like both of them, was just that you had to stay eligible and you had to have good grades and go to class and all that.
That helps. What position did you play in football?
I was a nose tackle.
Yeah. Had to be scrappy to play a nose tackle.
Yeah, I played both ways, actually. Because we were terrible. Like, maybe never won a game. Like, we won a, I don't even think we ever won a game. You know, we had a tiny little group of people. So, you know, you had to play both ways, you know, a lot of the better guys, you know. So I never come off the field, which I really liked. I enjoyed, you know.
Okay, strong work ethic there. Let's go back to high school. You just decide, hey, man, I question why we're doing all this. I'm just going to drop out. I don't see the value in it. What did you say to your mother or your father?
Nothing. And I just at some point stopped going to school, kind of like the movie Office Space. Have you ever seen that? Like, I don't even know. I can't even tell you, like, the point.
When did they find out that you quit school? I mean, did they not care? They'd say, Dean, I mean, because I would have got my ass whooped, but that's just the way we grew up in South Texas. You got to get your ass back in school, Steve. You're going to get a high school diploma. What'd they say?
I mean,
hey, Dean, just go out there and do whatever you can do. Good luck to you.
Yeah, because I was just kind of on my.
But how engaged was your father with you?
I mean,
this is where you need him to help you out.
He moved back into Ohio by the time I was in high. Yeah, I mean, he wanted always, you know, just wanted me to do whatever I wanted to do. You know, I was on my own thing, you know, like, and in high school, I was into some stuff I probably should have been into that kind of
made
it like probably stuff I can't talk about or shouldn't talk about that, you know, people shouldn't be doing, you know.
Okay.
And that also made it harder to go to school and just, you know, I was in a.
Did that
become I was a problem? I was a wreck in high school, you know. Okay. It's hard to even, you know, get into it, you know. But I mean, I was all over the map with but at the end of the day, you know, like, school came easy to me. If I'd wanted to just like go in there and get straight A's, and I could have, but you know, I just didn't. I was doing my own thing, you know.
But let's just say, your childhood a little discombobulated as compared to the norm.
I mean, yeah, in some ways, but I think I just early on developed a way of learning things for myself and looking at the world. I look at the world the way I look at the world, and I don't know any different. And I've pretty much always kind of been like that. So, I mean, it may be a little different, but I feel like people who grow up in a, you know, regular old, you know, nuclear families and, you know, follow the, go to high school, go to college, go get a job, do this, do that, they're miserable by the time they're 30, you know? I always just go with the wind, you know, wherever it wherever the wind blows, I feel like going, I just go there, I do that, you know what I mean?
Well, you're in a good business for that, because the wind, yeah. You know, with our business in sports entertainment, that's where the wind takes you. When did you start watching pro wrestling / sports entertainment as a kid? Or were you a fan at all?
Oh, yeah. Like, I can't really remember. I get that question a lot. You know, that's a standard question. And I can't really remember, like, a first memory of wrestling. Or, like, the first, I get, like, a lot of people have the first time I saw Hulk Hogan, I knew that's what I wanted to do. I don't have a first memory. I just don't ever remember a time when wrestling wasn't the thing that I liked. Like, every memory I have, as far back as my memory goes, wrestling was my favorite thing. I loved it, you know? Like, I was into it. And it was like, for me, it was like this other world that was like this perfect, cool world where, like, you know, good guys fought bad guys and, you know, like, it was just like, it was like a world that you wanted to be in, you know? You sit in front of the TV and you, like, just, you want to get into that world when you're a kid, you know? It was like a fantasy world.
You mentioned Hulk Hogan. Was he an inspiration to you, or who was your guy?
No, I missed Hulkamania. That was kind of like, I was born in 85, so when I was like 7, 8, whenever I first would have started watching wrestling, Brett would have been on top, you know? Brett was the first guy that was like the guy.
Brett the Hitman Hart.
Brett the Hitman Hart.
Right.
Yeah, I loved Brett when I was a little kid, you know? He was a man. I always liked Brett because he wasn't because he was the biggest or strongest. He was just like, he's a cagey son of a bitch, you know what I mean? And he, like, he put over, like, how announcers put over how technical he was and the endurance that he had. And, like, that was always very impressive to me, like, you know, 60-minute matches and stuff like that. And, you know, tricky holds and, you know, outsmarting Big Giant Bam Bam Bigelow and the big bad guy slips on a banana peel. I love that stuff, you know, as a little kid.
So how did you end up getting started in the business?
Well,
you watched enough of that? You said, hey, man, this is what I got to do?
Yeah, I just had, like, a feeling. I just always had a feeling in the back of my mind. Like, I don't know how to become a wrestler. Or it wasn't like I was walking around telling everybody I was going to be a wrestler. I just had a feeling in the back of my mind, like an intuition that I could do this and I could be a pretty good pro wrestler if I had ever had the opportunity to be a pro wrestler. I had no idea to go about doing it, you know? And I started to kind of, without really having a plan, becoming more, as I got older, more and more just, like, obsessed with wrestling. Like, I mean, you watch when you're a little kid and you play with the toys or whatever, but as I got older, you know, I became obsessed with watching not just what was on TV, but, you know, scouring all the video stores for tapes. You know, I used to shoplift stacks of tapes from every video store. I apologize to I would apologize to Blockbuster Video, but, like, they're not around anymore, so you can't come after me. But I would just acquire as many just tapes, that boxes of tapes, whatever came on the TV, I'd stick that 6-hour VHS tape in and just record everything and just sit there and watch it over and over and over. And then you get into, like, ordering stuff out of catalogs and getting, like, Japanese wrestling and stuff like that and learning more about, like, NWA and WCW and just learning about all this old stuff. And you read the magazines and read the books. And I started, like, compiling, like an encyclopedia in my brain, like a history of wrestling, like, oh, okay, there's, like, territories, and there's, like, different champions. You got Dusty Rhodes over here, whatever. And I started watching ECW. Loved ECW. Hey, that hit me, like, the perfect time. Right when I was, like, 12, 13, and you turn on ECW, you're, like, it just hits you in all the right spots, you know? Like,
sometimes when I'm watching you, sometimes I see a little bit of Terry Funk. And he would have come through ECW maybe at a time when you were watching, because certainly he was an older school guy. Was he a guy that you know, looked to as, hey, man, this guy's pretty badass?
Oh, I love Terry Funk, yeah. I love that ECW version of Terry Funk. Looking, you know, I wasn't like, he wasn't my favorite guy at the time or anything, but looking back, especially now that people compare me to him a lot, you know, you go back and look at, like, NWA champion type Terry Funk, he was awesome. Just mixing brawling with, like, with wrestling. And, like, I love all those, that's an aside, but I love all those old NWA champions, like, just watching, like, Harley Race and Ric Flair and stuff like that, and just how they are the world champion. You know, like, you watch Harley, this has nothing to do with what we're talking about, but I'm just gonna start rambling.
Right.
So, like, you know, you watch Harley Race, he's oblivious and does not care that there's even an audience. He's just out there, and I'm not even gonna try to beat this guy. He comes out there, challenger in the ring, I'm the champion, everybody knows I'm Harley Race, I'm the champion. This is the same goes for Jack Briscoe or a lot of those guys. Couldn't care less of this crowd here. Couldn't care less. I don't even have to try to beat this guy. What do you got? Try to take this belt off of me. Let's see what you got. Try. You know what I'm saying? Like, he had this, like, all right, who's this challenger? Let's see what you got. Because I know I'm the man. Everybody here knows I'm the man. And they were just like, they had a thing to them, you know? That I don't know if, like, you know, I would like to bring some of that to myself, you know, if I could.
Both of those guys, like Flair, Harley Race, had mentors. Who mentored you in the business?
I don't really particularly have one. I mean, there's been a lot, you know. I was trained by a guy named Les Thatcher's school in Ohio, and trained primarily in the ring by a guy named Cody Hawk, who all those guys at that school, that where I went, I didn't even know it was in Cincinnati. I couldn't be happier that I got a chance to go to this school in Cincinnati. It's called Heartland Wrestling Association Main Event Pro Wrestling Camp, right? And I see a flyer on a telephone pole for it. And this is at the period of time where I'm like, I'm just super obsessed with wrestling, and I'm like studying it and learning all this stuff, and like, but I don't have anything to do with that energy. I see a flyer on a telephone pole for a wrestling show. It's at the flea market for HWA. So I'm like, I gotta go to that, hell yeah. So I go to the show, and it's cool because it's like up close and personal. It's an indie show, and I'm like, whoa, these wrestlers are like, I'm right up on the ring. And on the program, at the very back of the program, it says, Les Thatcher's Main Event Pro Wrestling Camp. And it was like this light, it was like this serendipitous moment, this giant light shone down from the heavens. It was like, ah, and it was like, that's where I'm going. So I write like a letter and like try to get in and show up. And eventually I end up, you know, sweeping the floors and selling popcorn because I'm like 16 at the time. And by this point,
what trained you?
You had to be 18.
Gotcha.
So I had to hang out. And
so for 2 years, you swept floor, sold popcorn,
yeah,
paid dues.
And it was like a hard, because it was an old school camp. You know, Les wrestled in the 60s.
Right.
You know, like, he wrestled Ric Flair in, like, when he first came to, like, Charlotte, you know. He always says he was Ric Flair's first match in the territory, which could be suspect, I don't know. But, you know, I mean, that's how old he was. So this is an old school camp, so you have to learn everything. You do nothing but take bumps. You have to learn everything and do it perfectly before you get to learn the next thing. So you might just take bumps for 2 months until you can do that flawlessly, and then you get to learn how to lock up and yada, yada, yada until you can build the match.
So with all the tape study that you'd done, the countless hours that you'd watched, all the stuff that you compiled, the things that you shoplifted, maybe, were you a fast learner? Did it just come natural to you because you've watched so much of it?
Yeah, a lot of it did, to be honest. Like, a lot of it didn't, you know, because I can be a clumsy son of a bitch, you know, but a lot of the physical stuff, I mean, some stuff came easy, some stuff came, you know, but once I kind of started putting it all together after I'd been wrestling for a year or so, like, I started to feel like I was getting pretty good pretty quickly. It kind of made me being a little cocky, you know. But, I mean, it was 2 years of just getting my ass kicked and just training every day. I loved that school. Like, I would just live at that school. They gave me a key to the
But how was place. The school? Because, you know, when I watch your style now, if you hadn't told me that you'd had amateur background, I would never think that you did, because that's not a part of how you worked. And I've gone back to watch your stuff from all the places that you've worked, and you've really worked a pro style, or what less, or what you put together on your own, but there's no amateur stuff in there. Was that a conscious choice that you made?
Yeah, it's not really my personality, you know, like, I guess, I don't know, just none of that stuff ever, I don't know, I love that, because I was always taught that style was like calling the ring. Like, first match I had, being there with a veteran, don't even come up with a finish, you know what I mean? Like, you should be able to wrestle 60 minutes calling the ring. And it's harder to do now because, you know, the style's different and for television and so forth. But I started with and still kind of always defer back to that call it in the ring type of working, you know? And I like being in the ring with guys that are like that and kind of feeling it out on the go, you know?
When did you know that, hey, this is what I want to do for the rest of my life? Was there that serendipitous moment?
Yeah, like, all right, but before then, but yeah, I just went with the wind, you know? I just knew, you know?
But there was a time there for a while where you got out of the business, right? You just went back to a regular job.
No. What are you reading? The internet?
No, I'm watching. You talking about working at a health club. Fitness club. You don't remember that?
I've worked at a fitness club.
You've gotten away from the business.
Oh, there have been bad times, you know. I mean, I've never not worked the weekend or, you know, stopped wrestling or whatever, you know. there have been times, you know, because I spent a lot of time in the Indies where it'd be like, where you come really close to quitting, you know, where you go like, screw this, and you throw your hands up, you know, but you still go back. To, you still go,
but
you still show up at the show that weekend.
Why do you say screw this, let's just quit, just because it's the Indies? Is it the pay? Is it the long miles? What is it?
Yeah, I mean, all that, you start wondering. At some point, everybody, you know, you start, if you put in enough time and don't get rewards for it, you know, you start wondering, you know, what am I going to get? A shot, you know, when something's gonna happen, you know, you try to send feelers out here, you get nothing, you try to get a try out here, get nothing. But actually, those kind of failures are actually kind of the thing that kind of really helped me kind of get myself to the next level just inside myself. Because at a certain point, like, after wrestling for a few years and just kind of scraping by on the Indies and being like, man, this is like it might have been a bad idea. Like, you know, like I'm starting to get to the point where like, this may not work out as a success for me, you know, like.
Did you have a plan B?
No.
You bounced around from organization to organization, not bounced, but wrestled. And then you finally ended up in Puerto Rico.
I actually went there when I was like 20. I went there like pretty early on in my career. I had a great time there actually, because you know, that's what I really learned about, you know, being vicious. I was down there with Bushwhacker Luke, and you know, I was pretty young and, you know, could do some fancy little moves and had some pretty hair, you know what I mean? But like down there, they didn't care about any of that. You go down there and do a fancy move, they're like, cool, whatever, what else you got? You go out there and go, scream and yell and punch a guy in the face, like, you know, and that's what they want to see. They want that like blood. And so that's where I like really learned, I took viciousness away from that, you know, to go back to what I was saying earlier, like those kind of failures and coming like this close to being like, this wrestling thing is just getting old, not getting what I'm, but then that's when you start going like, I kind of made a decision with myself and went like, you know, I love wrestling and everything. It may not ever work out. I may not make like $1 million, but you know, I'm gonna put a hell of a body to work together because I'm really good at this. And I'm an awesome wrestler, I think, and I'm pretty good. And like, maybe 50 years after I'm dead, some people will go back and watch some stuff of mine and think it was really cool. Maybe I'll die broke and poor and never make anything of myself, and maybe I'll never get famous, but I'm just gonna be the best me I can be. And like, once I started doing that and just kind of going like, you know what, screw trying hard, and I just started being me all the time and just doing whatever I wanted, working however I wanted, saying whatever I wanted.
How long did it take you to gain that confidence?
Yeah,
was it manufactured as a wall? Was it true confidence?
Probably like 5 years in, I just went like, it's probably five years plus a couple years of training, you know what I mean? And years of, you know, just being a fan and studying this. Probably maybe like 2008 or so, I think I finally just went like, you know what, this is how it's gonna be from now on. And I'm just gonna put together the best body of work I can put together. And if I never make it, I don't care. And if WWE, if it's something WWE wouldn't like, I don't care, because I don't work there.
Okay,
and
you just said it.
You know,
WWE, was that the ultimate goal all from the start?
Yeah, I think, yeah. And at some point
you weren't shooting for WCW because they were still around, right?
No, they're gone.
Were they gone?
So,
okay.
Yeah. So
the like, dream was WWE.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's everybody's, you know, and I always knew in the back of my mind, you know, I would watch Raw or something occasionally and be like, who are these guys? Like, what was that? Like, I could be right there. I could be wrestling John Cena right now. This is, how the hell do I get there? I don't know. Maybe there's no way, you know? So I was like, well, I'm just going to go and be just as good as any of these guys over here. You know, even though they got all the spotlight and attention, I'm just gonna do my thing and, you know, whatever. And once I developed that attitude, that I think that ultimately is the attitude that brought me here, you know?
So how was it that WWE got in contact with you and said, hey man, we think you're as great as you think you are. We want you. Come on down.
Yeah, a guy named Joey Mercury got somebody to take a look at something. I don't really know who was involved in the conversation or how it came about. I mean, it wasn't like they were rolling out the red carpet for me or anything. I don't think anybody knew I was even coming in. And if they did, they probably didn't have any idea what they were getting. I got a phone call. I was living on my buddy's, in my buddy's extra room on the floor. in Philadelphia at a time, just kind of like I was working for a lot of companies up in the East Coast, so I was living in Philly at the time, just kind of, when I say living, I mean just like, you know, crashing on my buddy's floor. And I just got a call randomly one day from it was a 203 number, and I answered it because I get, you know, calls from, you know, a bunch of indies and promoters or whatever, and it was like, hey, this is it was a guy named Ty Bailey, who's not here anymore, and he's like, hey, this is Ty Bailey from WWE, how you feeling? I'm like, from where? I thought it was like a name promoter. He's like, WWE. I'm like, oh, okay, sure. And I thought it was like one of my buddies going like, hey, man, Vince McMahon calling, you want a job? I was like, sure, man, cool.
That's a rib.
Yeah, and I'm like waiting for him to drop the act. I'm like, who is this really? He's like, hey, yeah, cool. So my secretary will get a hold of you. I'm like, and I was probably being a I'm lucky I didn't screw it up because I didn't think it was real. I'm like, yeah, sure. Yeah, your secretary will get a hold of me. Yep. Gonna come in and pop the territory, be a big star. Yep. Okay, sure. Yep. Your secretary. Put the phone down. Like, hour later, I forgot about it. Like, an hour later, Joey Mercury calls me, who I know enough. I don't know how he got my number. I knew him enough that I knew his voice because I met him before and worked with him before. So he's like, hey, man, it's Joey Mercury. I'm like, yeah, what's up? And I knew that he was like in Florida, and I'm like, it's weird. And he's like, oh, did you get a call today? And I'm like, I did. And he's like, cool, man, congratulations. Can't wait to have you down here. And I said, let me call you back, man. Well, yeah, okay. And then I'm like, I'm processing this. I'm like, whoa, I'm going. And then they had like my info, and they had like, actually did have contact from a secretary. I was like, oh, whoa, this is all real. Like, Jesus Christ. Like, so I'm like, all right.
Dude, does anything get your tachometer revved up? You just got a call from WWE, the place you want to go.
Oh, I'm freaking out.
The be all end all, the way you talk about it is like, yeah, so yeah.
Yeah, well,
what excites you?
I like to have I like to bring a chill vibe. It's a very intense interview, you know what I mean? I can't just let you, you know, heat me up with your intensity.
I didn't
you know, we gotta be chill.
Putting asses in seats.
Damn right.
Talk to me.
What was that? Oh yeah. So yeah, I'm like, I was freaking out, obviously. I'm like going, oh my God, I'm going to do whoa. So I'm like, all right, I'm gonna go to developmental, and I went, all right. I'm sure they have no idea. If they'd have knocked on the door that day and seen me and been like, or if they'd have really known the kind of guy they were getting at the time, you know, the stuff that I was doing in the indies, and like, they probably would have never. I mean, I got lucky, and I was like, I'm not letting this slip by. And I'm like, but I'm not going to go down there and be like, put on a suit and be like, hi guys, thank you for having me. Like, I do everything I can to be a WWE superstar, because that wouldn't be me. I'm going to go down there and I'm going to be me. And it might work, might not, but I can only do it one way. I got to just go down there and be me. And I got down there and just went down and did what I wanted to do.
But that was a smart call, because you got to be you. What was it like in FCW? What did you learn? Hell, you done been in the damn business, seven years? What could they teach you?
I'm looking at it probably through different lenses now, but like, I actually had a great time there. I loved my time there, just because Dusty Rhodes.
You were there 2 years.
Yeah, Dusty Rhodes was the booker and the booker for the TV, and that was one of my favorite things about it. I mean, obviously it was frustrating because you start getting a chip on your shoulder. But it's not like it is now with NXT and stuff. Back then, we felt like we were on an island. Like, we felt like we were like the bastard children of WWE. Like, you forget you even work for WWE sometimes, because you get no contact with anybody. You're just kind of like, it just feels like you're working for this territory in Florida, you know? So there was a bit of that, but, you know, getting a chance to work for, work a television program written by Dusty Rhodes, who was like, if you're a wrestling fan, it's like Elvis. So like, you know, I'd get such a good time just sitting in the office with him and just listening to stories and talking about angles and so forth. And like, I it was just on like local television, you know, on FCW television, but I had two programs down there, one with Seth Rollins and one with William Regal, that I'm like very proud of from like a creative standpoint, as far as like a body of work, you know. I really, like, I'd put those up with anything I've ever done, you know, even though they were just in this little, you know, and being able to, you know, work with Dusty and stuff and all the producers down there. Like, I learned so much from Joey.
What did you learn from Dusty?
I learned so much from...
Because on a promo level, you know, and looking back at some of your old stuff, you got down there and you had to kind of, you know, learn what WWE was teaching as far as what they're doing in-ring. But just as far as promo goes, when did the light turn on for you? because I think it was before you hooked up with WWE, you just were doing a promo one time and you found a zone or whatever it was. And this is just watching an older interview that you did in the past. You found a zone and you just morphed into that. And that's when you kind of formed an identity. I guess it would be, you know, the genesis of what is now the Lunatic Fringe.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I was talking about earlier, when you find that spot where you just go like, all right, I don't give a damn. This is who I am, you know? Like, as far as like learning from Dusty, it was funny because we do these like promo classes. And I always, and still kind of do it, like, I just thought they were so weird and so stupid. Like, it was very awkward to me. They're like, okay, just everybody's sitting around and get up there and cut a promo. I'm like, about what? About who? It's not real. There's no, you know, it was very odd to me, you know? Like, I mean, I could do it, but like, I really had a bad attitude about that whole thing. But like, because I was like, I know how to talk, you know? Like, just, you know? And I always thought, like, I always thought I'd hear about like scripted promos up here, you know, like, oh, scripted promos. But I always thought, and this is me being naive, I always thought it was just like a myth, like a, like, there's not really scripted promos up there, because in FCW, we do whatever we want, you know, they just be like, you have a promo, I'd be like, cool, word, let's go. And figure once I got up here, there's not actually going to be scripts, right? Like, that's maybe if somebody needed it, or maybe, you know, but you don't really have to read the script. But no, the first time I got handed a script, it was like a,
so where would you say your promos are now, based from back in the day when, you know, you were wrestling as Jon Moxley, and all of a sudden you fell into that groove on that guy, and you were cutting some really edgy stuff that was badass. Compare the Lunatic Fringe Dean Ambrose with what you were doing, what, say, 6-7 years ago?
Yeah, well, it's...
You were out on a limb, brother.
Yeah, right.
I dug it.
Yeah, the Fringe, I guess, right? I didn't come up with that, but so like when I first started, when I first got here, you know, they give you the script and you got to kind of read it, and you're like, you say you're reading words. I can talk forever. Like, if you just put a mic in front of me and just say, just talk, I can talk forever.
But what is talking forever?
I mean, I can riff and talk. Right. But if you put a script in front of my face, I can't memorize three lines.
Gotcha. Okay.
I'm like, I'll forget them all. You give me a paragraph, I'll never remember it. But if you just say, just talk, I can just talk, right? So it was a little jumpy for me, just trying to get into a groove when I'm trying to, like, memorize lines. Like, it always kind of killed it for me, you know what I mean? Like, I was kind of like, it started to be like, I'm like, I hate doing promos, because all that is I got to memorize these lines. It's not fun anymore, you know? But now I've gotten to the point where, like, I can kind of call my own shots more a little bit, you know? And I can, you know, now there'll be times where Vince will just be like, say whatever you want. And, like, now it's like, all right, now we can finally get rolling here and do some work, you know?
What is your take on a promo? I mean, the message you're trying to deliver, because you're trying to reach in and make people believe in you and what you're about to try to accomplish. You got to move people.
Yeah.
Mister, can you make folks cry when you play and sing?
Yes.
David Allan Cole.
That's right. I knew that. You don't think I knew that?
So that's a promo. Effective and ineffective. Your mission on a promo.
Another part about promos that I find interesting that's not, that kind of gets taken away today, is that you can drive the narrative a little more in your promo, as far as like the creative part about how our angles are going to go or how our matches are going to go. Like, I could say back in the day, it's not how it is today, because now we have a creative team who drives the creative aspect of it, right? But back in the day, it was, I don't know, don't ask me, not my problem.
All right, so back in the day.
Back in the day, it'd be like, me and you are going to wrestle at the fairgrounds, right? Steve Austin versus Dean Ambrose at the fairgrounds. That's all I know. What, camera, shoot. And I'll just think up something in my head. I'll go, you know what, Steve Austin? I know something about you that all these people might not know. I know that you got a bum knee. I know that you've had 12 surgeries on that bum knee, and it ain't worth a damn. I know that knee, I know you can't barely stand on that knee, let alone get in the ring with me and take away my championship. So I'm gonna tell you what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna slap that figure four on you and make you scream in pain. I'm gonna slam your leg up against that steel post, and I'm gonna make you beg, I'm gonna make you ask me to amputate your leg because it hurts so bad.
you're going to hand your leg over to me on a silver platter, all right? You're going to give your leg up as a gift to the people of Nashville at the Nashville County Fairgrounds. That's what's going to happen. So now we have, like, a narrative for the match. Maybe we don't go to it. Maybe we do. But, like, it's just another thing. Like, man, maybe it's like, what if Austin's leg... And does Austin have a bad leg? You know, and now it's like another thing. Or you could be, you could come back with something else. You know, we can kind of create the story as we go.
Yeah, because Stone Cold said, "Well, hell, I'm going to whip your ass with one leg any day of the week, twice on Sunday." So to that, you would say what? And so we continue the story, but it's an organic fashion. Do you like people creating words for you because you're a free thinker? You know who you are.
Oh God, absolutely not. No. So don't. No, I hate. No, don't do that. I mean, I'll take a. Sometimes I'll be honest. Sometimes I get a suggestion. Because I'm open to everybody's suggestions. You can get a great idea from somebody who you never expect. I'm open to all suggestions. You know, sometimes I get, like, a great idea from somebody. I'm like, you know what? That was awesome. I'm going to steal that, you know? Like, so.
Do you?
As far as, like, putting words in my mouth.
Do you have a chip on your shoulder? Do you always feel like you have something to prove?
I have at times. Depending on this, when I first got to WWE and we're in the Shield and this goes to the other two guys, yes, for sure we had a chip on our shoulder because we felt like we were just as good or better than anybody in the company, and we were just down there making pennies in Florida on local TV, and screw everybody, we're gonna come in and kick the door down, and we don't really care if we get heat or nobody doesn't like us or anything, like, screw it, don't care. Big chip on the shoulder at that time. When I was like first starting in wrestling, yeah, definitely a big chip on my shoulder because I wanted to show the world that, like, yeah, I'm not joking when I say, like, yeah, I'm going to go be a pro wrestler, and I'm going to go, like, I'm going to be a big star. I'm going to be a WWE champion one day, like, and, you know, you get laughed at or whatever. Like, I'm being serious, and I'm going to make you prove you people wrong. You know why? Because you just accept your life and whatever crappy life you have here in Cincinnati. I'm going to work my ass off. I'm actually going to go do it because I'm proactive. And screw you. So yeah, chip on my shoulder back then. Nowadays, yes and no. Like I get chips on my shoulder and then I knock it off and then it comes back. You know, right now I don't consider myself a chip on my shoulder guy because I'm pretty. I mean,
are you saying you're complacent? You've lost your edge because you got that championship belt finally?
Yeah, not complacent at all, but not a chip on my shoulder as far as like a. What's everybody gonna like think of me? Like, you know, I'm gonna make sure I improve, you know, and whatever, you know what I mean? You gotta go. I have a confidence. Like, I mean, took a while to sink in, but now I feel like for sure, like when I walk down the ring right now, like I was saying about Harley Race and Jack Briscoe and stuff earlier, like, I mean, I take that and I think back to those years when I had a chip on my shoulder really bad and all that, you know, I think back to all that stuff. I think back on the journey. And I walk in that ring with this, like whether it's a house show in Tupelo, Mississippi, or Monday Night Raw, or pay-per-view, or SummerSlam, or whatever it is, when I walk in the ring with this on my around my waist or on my shoulder, I mean, it's serious. I mean, like, I am the WWE champion right now, and ain't nobody gonna take it away. You try to come after me. You try to say something like, you know, you don't deserve that, or, you know, I'm gonna take that from you, or whatever. You know, you're gonna get bit, you know? Like.
To me, this is all real. To you, yes, correct?
Yeah,
this business is real.
there ain't nothing fake about what I went through to get here to be sitting here talking with you. You know,
right?
I mean?
Because everything I did, I believed it was 100%. Shoot, I was all in. Let's talk about the formation of the Shield. You know, you three guys, you, Seth Rollins, Roman Reigns. What did you think? Whose idea was it? And say, hey, man, what you guys got to call you Shield? Were you like, hey, yeah, let's do it, or what?
It all happened. It was never it was all organic. It was never something that was came up within a meeting or whatever. Like we made it up as we went along. You know, I think that's what made it so special.
Were you guys friends to begin with?
Yeah, I mean, like I'd been wrestling with Seth for 2 years straight, you know, like we were friends with Roman, you know, like, and became super tight and like, you know, bonded in that experience of being like, as far as like how it came about, I think originally we were going to be like, Goons for Punk, who was the champion at the time. That never really came to pass, kind of. I don't really know how the backstage of the writing and it all came about, but it was just like, okay, you guys, here's some stuff to wear. It looked like security guards would come out. Actually, the first day we came out, they had given us shields, like giant riot shields.
How was that?
and I was into it at first. I'm like, yeah, look at this. And like his nightstick, I was like, I'm gonna beat the crap out of somebody with this. Hell yeah. And then in retrospect, if we'd have ran out with those, we would have looked so stupid. We would have looked like dorks, man. And one of us for sure would have tripped and fallen trying to get in the ring with that thing, and it for sure would have been me, and my career would have been over. So thank me, and my career would have been over. So thank God we didn't have the shields. But then it was like, okay, maybe we'll try to wear like tactical stuff. Like, so we go to the surplus store, get this, and then that becomes the look. And
that's
then,
a good
like,
look.
They make us, even coming through the crowd was just like, well, would they come out of the crowd? Because they're kind of invaders that are beating up the locker room. They should probably come out of the, they shouldn't come out of the dressing room, right? So then it became the, so it all just became, organically became what it was, you know?
What was the story within the chemistry, you guys? I mean, was it three alpha males? Did you say, all right, well, I'm not assuming you said I'm the leader, or did one of those guys say, hey, here's how it is?
No, yeah.
What was the pecking order?
I think that's the best way to put it, was three alpha males, you know? And I think we're all so different and have such different personalities that it made it so we didn't, there was really no stepping on each other's toes. And I think a lot of it, too, was the locker room back then, even just a couple of years ago, was a little bit different than it is now. Now I think I think there's a lot more young guys and the guys who came up in the all together and developmental, and you know, NXT guys filter in and everybody kind of knows each other and it's cool. Back then there was a big divisiveness between is that the right word? Divisive, big divide between developmental and the main roster. So if a new guy like me came up on the road for a dark match or whatever, you know, people are looking at me, kind of whispering, like, who's this guy? Is that that guy? You know, rumors get started. You know, somebody's just waiting. You know, it's a shark-infested water. Somebody's waiting for, you know, to stab you in the back. So, and we knew that, you know, so we came up there with, like, and people got it in our heads, too, that, like, people aren't going to like you guys, and they're not going to like this. But so we, you know, we all collectively went, dude, you know, Roman's like, I got a little baby girl at home. I don't care. I mean, Seth's like, dude, we've been doing this for way too long. Screw everybody, you know what I mean? We all just went in like all together and went, let's beat the crap out of everybody. And if anybody didn't like it, screw it. You know what I mean? Like it'll turn into a real fight. I don't care, you know? So we went in with that attitude and just in the work ethic thing, you know, we were just like, all right, we're gonna go out there and work harder than everybody, bust our asses, and just outwork everybody every single night and be the best thing on the show. And like, try to stop us, because you can't.
You guys started off and you came out and you had a head of steam, you know, kind of run a little bit of interference for Punk, whatever the backstory line was. And then you became cool. And then they decided to break you guys up. This is long story short. Did they break y'all up too fast?
No, it's perfect.
Why so?
Perfect.
How you feel?
Because you want to hit that, you hit that high note, you want to walk off stage. You tell your funniest joke, you want to walk off stage. You know what I mean? You want to have the biggest pop of your match be the finish, right? So, I mean, we'd gotten as high as we possibly could. I mean, I think we beat Evolution was like our last night. And it was like, we were crushing everybody. And we kind of just, there wasn't anybody else for us to kind of go after, you know? Like, it was like, we'd literally dominated WWE and stood atop it, and it was time to just walk off stage, you know? And because we were so hot, nobody expected it, which made it the perfect time, because a heel turn can't be expected, you know? And the Seth Rollins heel turn is one of the greatest heel turns ever, because it just came so far to left field. I mean, he's still hated for it today, you know? Look, what I mean?
Seth won the world title, Roman won the world title. You now have the world title, but at the time when those two guys were having their runs, you say, hey, what am I, chopped liver? Because, and listening to you talk, you're the best guy in the Shield. Hell, you're the best guy in the company listening
you're
to you.
Because you're getting me all fired up. I've tried to bring chill vibes in, and then you got me all fired up, you know? No, but I know what you're saying. Yes and no. I knew the breaks when the situation worked out how it worked out. I mean, originally we were doing this kind of like teasing a breakup storyline forever, where I was going to be the jerk out of it. So I'd been kind of intentionally being the biggest jerk and kind of being the sleaziest one of the Shield, like, forever, you know, because I knew eventually that'd make it easy for people to hate me, and because I never expected them to have to try to like me. But I knew the breaks, you know, when it was like, okay, Seth's going here and Roman's going here, and I knew my situation. And I went, all right, we'll see. And I remember saying to somebody who I'm close with, oh, in 1 year, they're going to have a baby face that they don't want. I didn't know it was going to be me. And that's, you know, phrased, that might not be the right way to phrase it, but that's exactly what I said. And And I went out there and I just went, all right, screw it. I don't know how I'm gonna do this, but I'm gonna go out there and I just started busting my ass in the, you know, the babyface role, and people started picking up with it, you know. And I remember, I will always remember this because it stuck with me and it like stuck in my craw, and it was one of those things that made me go like, all right, we'll see. Mm-hmm. Because it was shortly after that, I think we were going to like the Money in the Bank pay-per-view or something, or right after the Shield broke up. And I came out and did a thing where I attacked Seth and jumped off of something and the security guards or some kind of segment like that. And I cut a little promo. It's a little thing, right? And whatever we did, the place went bananas, right? And I was like, yeah, that was good. And I got to the back and I was like, whoa, that was awesome. Did you hear that? The place went nuts. And a producer who I won't name, you probably figured out who it is, came walking up to me and I was like, damn. And I'm like, and you know, he meant it as a compliment, like he was starting to say, you know, the crowd went nuts, but I'm like, oh, I see how it is. I'll remember that. And I remembered it.
Did you feel like you weren't designed to get over? Did you feel like it was you against the world?
Yeah.
And then in your calls?
I was sabotaged, but I was just left to my own devices.
Right, but it's...
Which was great, actually.
Do you think the Lunatic Fringe, you know, fans, the people that started buying into you and have bought into you now, it's we against the world, and man, for some reason you've, you know, gravitated towards, you know, a large portion of the people that watch the WWE shows?
Yeah, I mean, that's the message, if there is one, you know, like I really can't tell you what my like character is or whatever. I just go out there and be me, you know, all the lunatic and the crazy and all that stuff. That's all the stuff they put on me, you know, like, I don't know what all that is. If I had a message though, I mean, us against the world is kind of a cool thing. And this is the thing that is maybe the most rewarding thing. This kind of leads into of everything we get to do that we're, you know, fortunate enough to have this job, is that you get to a certain level when you're like in a babyface role or heel role in WWE where you can inspire people and you can help people and you can inspire people to get through things in their lives. You can inspire people to do things with their lives that they might not have the courage to do. You can help people through tough times because they know that you've been through something similar. You know, they watch you every week and they see you struggle and they see you succeed and they go like, I can do that too. And that you get to be like such an inspiration to these people, and you get a chance to meet these people, you know, every week in whatever country, you know, you meet all these people who are crying and you help me get through this and whatever, and thank you so much and you mean so much to me and yada yada, and you know, stuff, and like getting to do like, you know, stuff like Make-A-Wish and stuff like that.
But those people get a chance to live vicariously through your storylines. And I dare I say, going back to you as a kid on the streets of Cincinnati or wherever you were at, Bret Hart did the same for you.
Exactly. Yeah. And it's such a like an honor to be in that position, to be able to like, you know, meet those people and do the Make-A-Wishes and stuff. And you know, like I used to hear it like when I first got here, like, you know, we put smiles on people's faces. And like that sounds real corny and cheesy when you hear it, because I'm like, no, smiles on faces. No, I want violence. I want blood. Like, let's do some pile drivers, you know, because I'm a wrestling fan. But then you get to the position and you're given this responsibility, like a John Cena would have or whoever, and you go like, oh, like you meet these people and you go, that's what it is about. Like it ain't about all this or that. Like it's about putting smiles on people's faces.
It's the big picture. Yeah. Hey man, speaking of big pictures, let's go back a little bit because WrestleMania 32 in Dallas, Texas was a hell of a picture. Over 100,000 people there. You walking down that ramp. I walked down the same ramp you did. It was badass to be in front of 100 grand. You going there to face Brock Lesnar. What are you thinking out there, dude? Just. He's a friggin' beast.
Yeah.
So how was that feeling for you? And certainly, if you ever were an underdog, you were an underdog in that match.
Yeah, it's pretty cool, you know. We went to the ring. I went to the ring that night pretty pissed off. And then I really started to enjoy, as I walked to the ring, because I had no idea what was going to happen. Went out there with... not much of a plan, so to speak, you know, like to get into it.
What were you pissed off about?
I felt like I was pulling teeth to turn that match into something epic and so forth.
You're an MMA fan just like I am. Was it a disconnect in styles?
I mean...
Artistically? I mean, in the ring?
Yeah, artistically, Brock didn't want to do anything. To be perfectly honest. And because, you know, Brock's going to Brock. He's all about Brock. You know, I had a vision for that match to be the craziest thing imaginable. You know what I mean? And I was trying to pitch everything to everybody and had every idea. And just I put so much effort in, so much work in. And other people did, too. And you know, and I was met with laziness. And but I just kept thinking at the end of the day, I was like, once we get in the ring, it's all going to be okay. We'll figure it out once we get in the ring. And... you know, went out there and we whacked each other with weapons. I got suplexed a bunch of times. And, you know, it's a cool, it's an invigorating feeling walking in the ring knowing that, like, you're going out there with a man who can kill you with his bare hands in front of 100,000 people and you have no idea what's going to happen. It's pretty cool, you know? So then, like, I live for moments like that. So it was a hell of a day, I'll tell you.
Let me ask you, as I sit here and look at that belt, I held that belt a few times, a different version of it, but the world champion. What does the WWE Championship mean to you on a personal level?
I think for me, it symbolizes that you know, nobody, if you believe in yourself, nobody can screw with you. Don't let anybody tell you no. You know, if people, you know, don't accept negativity from anybody. You know, a lot of people want to put their negative vibes on you nowadays, you know, especially today. In today's society, a lot of people like to give their negative vibes. People are just, you know, don't take any of that. You just, you do what you want to do, do your own thing, you know? And like, and for me, it's it symbolizes, you know, that for me. And it's a chance to help and inspire other people like that, like I said, because I've been put in this position that I take very seriously as, you know, I mean, Jesus Christ, like, I'm like a role model to children. Isn't that weird? I would have never thought in a million years, you know, but it's a responsibility that was been given to me, you know what I mean? And I take that very seriously, you know what I mean? I might not be
the atypical
role model for children, but like, hey, you know, I still got a message, you know? And that message is, you know.
How's your relationship with Vince McMahon?
Oh, it's great.
How great is it?
Me and Vince are boys. I'm his favorite.
How well do you know that guy?
I mean, pretty well. Vince is pretty, he's a unique individual, you know? And a lot of people, you know, a lot of people then are intimidated by Vince or get the wrong idea of Vince. But, you know, I find him very easy to talk to. He doesn't want to be, you know, glad-handed to, you know what I mean? Like, I'll go right into Vince's office and be like, what's up? He'll be like, hey, what's going on, you know? I had a 45-minute conversation with him at 2:30 in the morning the other night, you know? He's going to work out. Because he's crazy like that, you know? That's serious. That was in the lobby of the hotel. He's got his creatine, and he's got his cut off sweatshirt, and he's ready to go, you know? I'm like, I'm certainly not going to work out at 2:30 in the morning. But, you know, if you, people forget about Vince, you know? He's a CEO, and he's an executive, and a billionaire, or whatever. But, like, at heart, man, Vince is a street fighter at heart, man. Vince is a trailer park street fighter at heart, you know? He loves that, you know? He loves that, like,
he's
one of the boys.
Does he understand who and what you are?
I think so, yeah.
Being a street fighter? Because, yeah. I mean, seemingly that's the same way you came up.
Yeah, I think he does. Yeah, I'm Vince McMahon's favorite wrestler. Cool me.
Hey, how do you feel about the brand extension?
He won't admit it, but I am. He knows. What?
Let's talk about the brand extension.
Oh, I love it.
Why?
Because, one, more opportunities for guys, you know, that... and less overexposure for guys. You're talking about 5 hours of wrestling with the same storylines and stuff. You got to come up with twice the amount of content, you know? Because sometimes there can be too much build up to a match because you start running out of ideas to, you know, you got to fill time, you know? You got a 3-hour show, you know, you got to fill time. So you start giving away a lot of stuff. You know, I can't tell you how many 20-minute, 30-minute matches I've had with Bray Wyatt, Kevin Owens. You know, after a while, it's just like, I feel like we've done this a lot of times on TV, you know? But you got to fill time with however you can. So I think overexposure, helping of overexposure is one of the good reasons. The other reason is, one, everybody's going to get an extra day off at home, which I think is going to be great for everybody for just, you know, health and purposes like that, you know, and just recharging everybody's batteries. And the other reason is I like that I was able to kind of be put in the position of kind of having the C on my jersey kind of thing, you know, like, you know, they put a crew on Raw and a crew on SmackDown, and I kind of got to be the captain of SmackDown, you know, at the beginning. So, you know, I like being in that position.
Are you leadership? Are you a leader by nature?
Not in the way that, like, not in the way like a John Cena would be, or a guy like that who will bring everybody in and have a meeting and give guys advice and so forth like that. And not like, all right, everybody round up, you know, I'm going to tell you some stuff, you know. Not that that's bad. I'm not in that way. I prefer to be a leader by example. Kind of going back to that, like, we'll just go in and work harder than everybody else every night, and that's it. I'm more of a leader by example kind of guy. I'd rather everybody look, if anybody's going to have to look at me as an example, I'd rather them look at me, just look at me and go, I want to be like that guy because he works his ass off, more so than like, hey, everybody, let me lead you. Like, I'm not like that, you know? That's not my thing.
Are you comfortable with where you're at right now?
I'm comfortable in that, like, it feels good. But, like, now I feel like it's time to really get to work. Like, I like that I'm finally in a position now where I feel like I got a little bit of I can have a little bit of creative freedom on the mic, and I'm in a good position, like, as far as, like, you know, kind of a captain in the blue brand. And now we can really sit down and get to work, because there's just kind of a long time, a lot of work to get to this point. And now I'm like, all right, now we can I can really start to build, hopefully, what would hopefully years from now be like a legacy, you know, or I can get to work on really, you know, putting together a championship run and, you know, just building the body of work and doing some stuff I've always wanted to do, you know, like, so I'm excited to get to work. You know, as WWE champion.
Aren't you excited to get to work? You got the gold belt, WWE, lots of diamonds, whatever on the front of that belt.
Yeah, it's real shiny, man.
You're proud of that thing. You got the DA on it.
They signed it before, too.
It has taken you a long time to get here, Dean. A long-ass time. You have paid your dues. And doing my research about you, I didn't know how many times you'd been around the block. All of a sudden, you end up on top of the WWE universe. Me, I'm sitting right here. I'm 5 feet from your ass. I got a challenge for you. I've been watching you ever since you rolled in, and I'm proud of you. I'm happy for you. Nothing's ever been handed to you. You've earned everything you got. But as a guy who back in my day pushed the envelope and just pushed it, I wasn't afraid to go out on a limb because I didn't really give a rat's ass. I was going to go and watch some of the stuff that you've done in the past. I challenge you now to raise the bar. I'm challenging you right here on the WWE Network, on the Stone Cold Podcast, to push the envelope, go out on a limb, be edgier, take more chances, be more Dean Ambrose, whatever that means, Lunatic Fringe, the tagline they gave you. I'm challenging you to amp up and amplify everything you've got, because I think the WWE Universe deserves to see that. And you've shown a lot of that, but I would dare say you've rested on your laurels, you're a little bit comfortable, and you need to find the edge again. So this is no me. I'm challenging you to push the envelope and go for it. To that you say what? Have you been in the safe zone? Am I missing something?
Rested on my laurels? I am offended by that, but
I want the best out of you, and so do these people that are watching this damn show every Monday and every Tuesday, which you're the captain.
Yeah.
I don't want to, Dane. Give it to me. Give it to the people. This is what you've worked your whole life for. Do you understand what I'm saying?
I like it.
Is this a disconnect?
No, I mean, as far as, you know, pushing the envelope and stuff, you know, I mean, I try every day to push the envelope as much as I can. And sometimes, you know, you gotta, sometimes you can yell and scream and beg, can we do this? Can we do this? As much as you want. And you still, but at the end of the day, you know, you're playing in Brother Sandbox, you know. But I like that. And you're reminding me that, you know, like, getting on top is one thing, staying on top is a whole nother thing, you know. And like I said, I'm excited about getting to work and excited for the challenge. But now I feel like feel like you put me on blast a little bit, and I like that. You know, I mean, as long as we don't end this with a stunner.
You can't block a stunner. I will not let you block a stunner.
I already know the counter.
They give me the counter?
Yep.
You can't do it. They give me the go home cue. It's time to wrap up this podcast and ride off into the sunset. I'm sitting here in Anaheim, California.
It's like the ending of
Rocky down the road from the mean streets of Los Angeles, California, where I make my home. I've been talking with the lunatic friends, Dean Ambrose. I wish you nothing but the best. You work your ass off. Continued success.
Oh, thank you.
Steve Austin here on the WWE Network. We hope we give you $9.99 worth, and we'll catch your ass down the road. We are signing off, and that's the bottom line, because Stone Cold said so.